what the yarn?
Your magic wand.
88,268.
Sent out for lunch?
No, I just took it. I did when I wrote up my recommendations, because I had to do, I had to get some data.
It's all that in-between talk that is that old.
You don't sit there and read everything? Charlie. You've always been a...
Cities are fairly simple. Excise taxes, that's all there is. Basic rules for those, but that's about it. And most of those, let's see, the excise taxes. Charter. Property taxes, you have to have voter authority to levy.
It's better.
Under property tax, you have, if you don't have one, right, and you want one, you got to go.
Two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight.
Whatever the levy is.
Just about half.
And after that, it's.
Right, so we're here. One, two, three, four.
Secondary.
Three. Four.
Some cities, I know Avondale, some cities that have charters, Goodyear has a charter. They want to change.
And we haven't approved anything in March. Doesn't show it.
Oh, I gotta put my tag on.
City's done here, the city did.
This one, we include the charter for that.
Okay.
Good evening, folks. Good evening. Welcome.
Good evening.
For anybody that didn't see the end of the hockey game, we won.
We won?
Yeah, which is quite a remarkable feat for those young men against the Swiss team. Okay, well, this is the off week. This is the week we do not take comments from the public. We will again next week. Is there anything from, so if I could call the meeting to order, is there anything from last week that we didn't cover, should have covered, that you'd like to have more on? I have one request for more detailed information on the fire. House, you have a summary bit in the report. There's more data to follow on that. You asked last week for a comparative representation of the 2009-10 budget year to date. That will be presented next week. You can add that on the, I think it's the third tab in, on your projected dates coming up. You can add in the compared 2009-10 data after city manager's office on March 3rd. If you recall, we thought that was probably going to take 2 weeks to get ready to bring back. And we also have, and I know I didn't think we talked about this specifically, but the question arises again on March 17th, which is the Wednesday night in which this building, this space is occupied, creates the option for you to do a meeting on the evening before. You don't have to decide that now, but just something to think about as we go forward, as we did last Tuesday, to add that meeting in at your discretion. Is there anything from last week that you'd like to bring up, folks? Yes, sir.
Were there handouts last week, and is there an extra set?
Yes, sir. There's a set. Anybody who missed any meetings, all your handouts are up here with your name on them on this table to my left.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
On firefighters?
Yes, sir.
In 2010, the number went from 31 to 42. And I know you don't have the numbers in front of you, but I've got those numbers.
Yes, sir.
I'm curious about the paramedics along with that. They seem to have dropped. Did they merge them in some way? Would anybody be able to figure that out?
I don't know, sir. We'll definitely get that answer to you. The question going from 42 to 31, was it?
31 to 42.
Or 31 to 42.
Which is an increase.
Increase.
And paramedics apparently dropped considerably.
Let us get that answer for you, and we'll post it. Thank you. We have minutes. No, you have your handout, which is in the same format. It is weekly, a new agenda, the changed table of contents, hard copies, two up, easily readable for tonight's presentations, and the minutes from the previous meeting. So with that, we have one change that we need to make to the minutes, and that's under committee members present, the comma between Eidelman and Charles, so that doesn't look like one really, really long name. Are there any other changes to the minutes that anyone might have? Could we get a motion to approve those minutes?
So move as amended.
Move as amended. A second, please.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Our first presentation this evening, we have two, and I'm really eager to see the Citizen Satisfaction Survey, which is summarized in the last 20-some pages, 27-page report, second to last in your handout.
Mike, any possibility we can move that?
Beg your pardon, sir?
Can we move that to the front of the agenda tonight by chance?
The customer, would people prefer to see that first or second? We just got to get them queued up, but I'm sure we can change them. Yes, sir.
My only concern, if you previewed it, it's 54 slides. It's a lot of information
right. That
I think is very well summarized almost in the last few slides. So I don't know if it makes a difference which position we can do it in, but if we don't spend an hour on every slide, we won't be here until midnight, I guess. I don't care what order we do it in.
For me personally, information in that survey, I think, is really important.
Oh, it is.
I want to make sure if we have adequate time to discuss it, even at the risk of maybe not having the same amount of time.
Okay.
I
think that's a good point. How do others feel about that?
What is the
question is, could we move, would there be an advantage to moving the discussion of the citizen survey up to the first thing on the agenda tonight to make sure that, because of the importance of the data, you have the time to discuss it? We can presumably still get everything in, but if for some reason we don't by 9, we'll slide it forward. Is that okay, folks? Anybody opposed to doing that? Then can we, without too much trouble, switch and have the presentation now
sure,
on the citizen survey?
As long as we can get the...
I think he's probably changing it in the sound booth as we speak.
Thank you, everyone. I appreciate it. Chase.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Pardon me?
Paula Ilardo is going to make the presentation on this.
Yes, okay. Well, you can come down and do the presentation. Yes. Good evening. We have a special. This one doesn't point, but we have a pointer, don't we?
No, it doesn't work on.
It'll only work on these two screens. It will not work on those.
For me to present and point backwards. Eddie, if he could get it.
Can you use this? It doesn't. Does it show up behind us? Yeah, it's showing up over there. Shows up everywhere.
It's showing up there?
Uh-huh. There you go.
Special mouse is here.
There you go.
Okay, thank you. This looks like this special mouse is already here. So don't worry, it only took me half an hour to present it at council, 54 slides in half an hour. So the citizen survey we do.
Yeah, what you need.
We've been doing it since 2001. We did it in 2001 and 2002 with the community college. And then in 4, 7, and 10, we've used a professional firm, Behavior Research. And when we do it, we have a random computer-generated telephone sample. And this year we did it in late January, in evenings and weekends, in order to get the most people. Basically, it's the same questionnaire design as in 2007 for comparability. And then we have special questions each year that we ask that pertain to issues that have come up that year. It's about a 20-minute survey. This year it had 84 questions. In other years, it's actually had more. The important thing about this is that when you do surveys, there's always a sampling error. In this case, it's 400. It's a 5% sampling error. You could go to 600 to get a 4.2 sampling error. So 400 is acceptable, a very acceptable sample size. So when you're looking, when you're looking at the total sample of 400, it has to be a 6% difference in order to be significant. Otherwise, it could just be a sampling error. When we're looking at subsamples, which I do sometimes, of areas of the city or by age, then we need to see a 10% difference between them to be a significant difference. So keep that in mind, 6% for total, 10% for subsamples.
I've got a question. Is this your telephone survey, is this landlines?
Yes, it does include cells. The areas of the city that we went, when I refer to the north, it's north of I-10. When I refer to central, it's south of I-10 and north of the Gila River. And when I say south, it's south of the Gila, which basically means it's Estrella. Okay, the profile of our respondents this year, as you can see on the left column, on the left column, it says that basically 53% of the respondents were under 49. And if you look at the other areas, the south is most comparable, and the north is generally much older in population, in age. Over 53% of the population is under 49, generally said, and we had 55% female and 45% male. You'll find we have really high level education levels in the heads of households of our households, and we ask that. We ask, are you college educated, meaning you have some college? So 85% of one, if there are one or there are two household heads, at least one of them is college educated. And the same would go hold true with the 56% college graduates, that at least one head of household is a college graduate. Those are pretty high numbers for a city. Length of residency, last year we were 50-50. Lived here under 5 years or over 5 years, not last year, in 2004 sample, was 50-50. And at this point now, we have 60% of our population has lived here longer than 5 years, and we actually have 20% of our population that has lived here almost 10 years. So we're aging as a city. Our respondents, we ask about the employment status of both respondent and their spouse if they had one. And as you'll see, under respondents, the yellow is 2010 and the purple is 2007. That there are fewer of the respondents employed this year than last survey, and that is significantly lower. And you'll see the difference is significantly higher in the number that show they're unemployed. So I would say this is very typical for the economy right now. The spouses, 6% lower in employment, which is significant, and 3% showing up unemployed there. You see the retirement rate of both of them up. Some of that could be a result of the economy and people have taken retirement because of the economy. Then we wanted to know how many of our household heads actually have a head of, how many of our households actually have a head of household who works in our city. And it turns out that 24% of every household here has at least one head of household working in Goodyear. It's not a great number, as you probably all know. I mean, how many of you commute out from our city? How many of you work in our city, I should ask the question? How many of you commute out of our city? I don't see any hands. Do you not work?
I work at my house.
Oh, okay. All right, so 76% of all the households commute out of our city. So you'll see throughout the study that jobs became important to these people. So from the respondents and the spouses, we asked, how many miles do you one way? And as you see, the yellow boxes here, not the yellow bars, but the boxes, 79% of respondents, 81% of the spouses travel more than 20 miles round trip. And the red box, almost about 40% of the respondents or the spouses travel more than 40 miles round trip, many of them going 60 miles round trip. Annual income level didn't change from 3 years ago. Basically, we had 47% of households over 75, making over 75,000 then, and the same today. And three quarters of our population make 50,000 or more. Now, this is the first year we ever ask about voter registration, and as it turned out, 92% of our households are registered, 87% of the respondents, and so I didn't find very many differences by whether they were a registered voter or not, since they represent such a large part of our sample. However, when we looked at the profile of those registered voters, as you can see, 67% is the lowest number in the age of under 35. So I think it can be expected that your younger population are those that are less likely to be registered. I was sort of surprised that 35 to 49 is the highest percentage. I actually expected it to be older, and that number going down as they age. So I'd say this might be sort of a unique community with 35 to 49-year-olds having such a high registered voter.
I think part of the question is answered by the fact that most people do not have a landline. And if they don't, they're probably younger people with cell phones.
That could be the case. The length of residence, but by age, they're represented normally. We have younger people. The representation by age in the sample is representative of what the age is in our population and by the areas they live in. The length of residence, the longer they've lived here, the more likely they are to be a registered voter, but there's no difference by the area that they live in. And what's the status of children in the household? Less than half of our households have children, 46% do, sort of spread across all the age ranges. Of the areas in the city that have children, the central is by far the largest. 60% of all homeless children reside in the central area of the city. We asked those households, is anybody in your household interested in getting a college degree? And 38% in total said they were. And as could be expected, the younger the household, the more likely people were to want a college degree. And as can be expected, in the central area where there's most children in the household, that was the highest percent that said they wanted to get a degree. We ask in what? Healthcare was the highest, 40%, computer technology, 39%, business, 37%, teaching, 35%, liberal arts, 25%. And the degree sought primarily bachelor's followed by master's. Then we got in the questions of, you know, how is it to live here? And we looked at the excellent and the good ratings combined. So as you can see, over the years, by each area, there's very little difference in any area as to how they've rated the city since 2004, 2007, and 2010. At this point, 90% of the people think it's either an excellent or good place to live. The only difference that we see is the central area is basically, the north is highest, and the central area is significantly lower than the north, I would say, with about 86%. So there's just some difference in the central area as feeling that it's as good a place to live as the other areas of the city. Same you'll see with quality of life. When you ask about quality of life within your neighborhood, the number went down a little bit to 85%, but overall across the different areas, it hasn't changed much. Quality of life, however, in the central area was significantly down from last survey, down to 76% from 85%. Now another number, which is very interesting, is the day and night safety number. This is about the only question that's actually stayed the same since 2001. So since we ask it the same all these years, we could compare it across the board. What's interesting is that after almost 10 years and triple the population, 98% of our people feel safe in the day, same as they did in 2001, and 90% still feel safe in the evening. That's not significantly lower than 2007 or 4. It is significantly lower than back in 2002. But as we saw from Mark's, Chief Brown's figures, the crime rate is down everywhere. And I think this is really remarkable when 98% of your people say they feel safe during the day and 90% at night. We asked them on an open-ended basis. Now, open-ended is we're not reading them any answers. We're just saying, okay, give us an answer. We said, what's the most important problem facing the city? And this year, it was the city's budget problems. So it shows you're an important committee. And after that, employment and jobs. And after that, housing foreclosures. So the top three, basically, are economy-based.
Excuse me. What was the exact question you asked them for that slide?
What do you feel is the most important problem facing the city?
Okay.
Four hundred.
So everyone answers
on the open-ended. They might say not sure, but they answer it. As you'll see from these, now when we get down to the other yellow bars, crime, growth too rapid, they're little tiny numbers, 5%, 4%. The reason I included them here is to show you the difference in the answers that we got in 2004 and 2007 when we were growing so rapidly. Then the biggest problem facing the city was the rapid growth, keeping up with growth, and the traffic congestion. Now, when we ask about, when they say traffic congestion, to be honest, we're not sure whether they mean I-10.
I-10.
Or if they mean our streets. We fixed a lot of our streets, too, in the past 5 years. So, but I think in their minds, mostly it is probably I-10. What's it, and then we ask them, open-ended again, what can the city do to make it more livable? And in this case, again, one of the highest is more parks and recreation. For the first time, really, more jobs. And then more shopping and dining was 8%. And if you'll see, if you notice, in purple in 2004 was higher. So, I mean, we did add a lot of shopping and dining since 2004 in our city. And at the very bottom, when improved city services, you can see that that's gone down. The need for that has, looks like it has gone down every year. Next we ask, well, how well has the city done in balancing the operations budget? And we put, again, we combine the excellent and good ratings to get a, just know how many were positive. And so 58% of the population said that they thought we'd done a good or excellent job in balancing the budget to date.
Excuse me again. You didn't ask this question in 04 or 07? And so
it
can
had
you-
budget problems back then. So it wouldn't have been a problem, it wouldn't have been asked. But many things are asked.
So this question was going to be asked whether or not budget was a problem in the previous slide or not. It was on your survey list?
Survey, yes.
It was on the survey list?
On the survey.
And can you read exactly what you asked, what question you asked?
Copied the survey, but I copied the 2007 survey. Basically, it was how well has how that's what basically the headline. How well a how good a job has the city done in balancing the operations budget? It was a very simple question. I mean, we can I didn't bring the right one to be honest with you.
And you didn't have many answers that said I don't know.
Well, we may have, but they weren't
not
in the majority of positive.
Huh?
I just have combined the excellent and good.
And there were very few, I don't know.
There usually are very few. If there were that many, if they were at all in the majority of I don't know, then I would include them, but it's usually not a very large number.
Mm-hmm. Scott Mikes, I just had one quick question on the, when you have those open-ended questions, am I assuming that some people could have said just one thing and some people could have said four or five of those things?
In open-ended, yes.
In the open-ended, okay.
In this case, 35 to 49-year-olds were the ones who appeared to be, if you want, more negative than the total sample. And in, by area, it, the northern people in the north generally were more positive. We asked a question about the attitude toward the continuation of the increased half-cent sales tax. now to do this, we read them, the statements, and said, the ones that, the bottom one said, I don't mind keeping it longer than 3 years if it helps keep services. I want it removed, but not until the economy is stable, even if it takes longer than 3 years. It's important to remove it in 3 years, no matter what state the city's budget or the economy is in. And the last one is make every effort to remove this before 3 years.
So this was another open-ended question?
Statements were read to them.
Okay, and they were asked to choose one of those statements.
So a third of them said, I don't mind keeping it longer than 3 years if it helps keep the services stable.
What was the demographic of these questions they were asked?
For this particular one?
Were they small business owners, just residents?
Just residents. And there were no general differences between them, or I'll show you the attitude one on the next slide. 30% then said, I'll remove it in 3 years, or remove it, but not until the economy's stable enough to remove it. So we called those two more generally positive, even though the yellow one said it's important to remove it, but you can keep it for the 3 years. It's the most negative would have been the one in the red that says make every effort to remove this before 3 years is up.
A follow-up. You sampled 400 residents, is that correct? Not 400 businesses slash residents. So, and the division between somebody who has a business or at least works here was one in the 14% that you showed us in an earlier slide. But basically the entire survey is done on residents who live in Goodyear and pay taxes.
They're asked if they are a resident of Goodyear.
Yeah. Versus a business owner who doesn't live here. Okay, thank you.
These residents for longer than a certain time period, I may have zoned out, or are they just, if they say they're resident, then they're in.
Or they're a resident. And 40% of them had lived here less than five years or less. 50% more than 5 years. Okay, the attitude toward the tax by age group, and gender and location. Females were more definitely more positive than males toward the tax, and the younger people were more positive than older people. And by area, it appears that the Australia people were more positive than the other areas. There was no difference by whether they were registered voter or not. Okay, then we also asked them about commercial development. How do you rate the design, look, quality, excellent, good, fair, poor? And at this point, 84% this year, just like in 2004, said that it's rated at excellent or good.
Sorry, but you're in this slide here, you're saying the white amounts are, those percentages are considered positive, and the yellow portions are considered negative? The one that's... 25. So
white is positive.
So you're saying someone who says remove the tax, but not until the economy's stable, you're calling that's positive, not negative?
In the previous slide.
Yeah.
Yeah, remove it, but not until the economy is stable.
Even though they think they ought to remove the tax.
We didn't give them really the option of not removing it.
Well, I thought you said these were the four choices that they had. One is... don't mind keeping it, and the other one says remove, the other one says important to remove, and the other one says make every effort to remove.
He said don't mind keeping it longer than 3 years if it keeps services. You're right, that one could be, it could be construed forever.
Well, that's positive. I would say that's positive.
That's the most positive one.
Right, but why are you considering remove the tax as positive?
Because they said not to do it until the economy is stable and the budget's stable.
Okay. Well, I guess I would argue that anybody wants to remove a tax, that would be negative towards the tax, no matter when they say they want to have it removed. That doesn't seem to me to be a positive statement. It seems to be a negative statement. So based on that, your next slide, I would say, is backwards. To me, there's much more negative impact to a tax than there is positive impact based on that. I mean, we're saying 30 65%+ of the population wants the tax removed.
3 years from now, Howard, that's the minimum.
Okay, well, you're qualifying it, okay? But my statement is still true. 65% of the people you surveyed want the tax removed. Is that not a true statement?
That is not a true statement. That
well,
is a qualified
I think you're wrong.
Statement.
Paula, could we continue the presentation?
We looked at the overall satisfaction with services over the years. I'm sorry. Mike?
I appreciate the interest to try to keep the present moving forward, but I'm still want to make sure that I think we had an important point there. And we had some different points of view. I just want to make sure I'm clear. We have a consensus understanding of what that chart says.
I'm confused.
If I could, the term and the question that has different viewpoints on it is the question, the statement that
where I drew the
remove
line.
But not until economy is stable, if longer than 3 years. Had that question been, and I understand that's the way it was worded, had it been worded, are you in favor of this tax staying in place for a minimum of 3 years, it would have presumably said yes. So I think it's a question of interpretation of what the intent was in response to the question, because the intent may have been, I'm happy with the tax for 3 years, possibly, but I'd like to see it removed as soon as we can remove it and still have a good, strong community, which still has the bias for no tax at some point in the future, but it has that point in the future as its markation. I think there's two ways to look at that, and I think, Paul, if you want to expand on that, just so we don't have this.
The reason that we looked at it as positive, if they didn't want to remove it at the three-year mark, well, and they said we'd still like it to be removed, but we want to wait until the budget's stable, the economy's stable, meaning that when the time is right, council can remove it. Otherwise, the people said it's important to remove it in 3 years, no matter what, no matter what the state of the budget is, no matter what the state of the economy is. Those people, to me, want it removed. The people who really want it removed say, make every effort to remove this before the 3 years is up, the 3 years that the council put on it. That's the difference in my interpretation of what's positive versus negative.
Well, but it jades your other charts, the way you do that. To remove means to eliminate. So if somebody says remove it, but not until the economy is stable, it's still saying remove it. They're not happy with it, right? So, like Howard said, it shades your other slides.
Okay. I disagree. The people are happy with it being in place. I'm not any happier than anybody else paying an extra half a cent sales tax. But if it's going to maintain the city services that we're accustomed to right now, I'm happy to pay it. If it takes longer than 3 years, that's fine too. I would, if that was my point of view, speaking as somebody who would get that question, I would say that I have a positive outlook on the sales tax question, period. So I think it doesn't matter. It matters whether you call it the glass half empty or the glass half full. We're saying the same thing. It's just where do we draw the line and what do we – we're going to interpret the data any way we want to. I hate to oversimplify it, but that's the bottom line. Everybody has their preconceived ideas of how they feel about the tax.
Monica?
I would just second your point that this is really open to interpretation. A lot of it has to do with the construction of the question itself, because even this don't mind keeping it is not an affirmation that they're pleased with it. So I would have to say that the structure of the questions may cause some ambiguity, but if we collectively think about the intent of the question, we might have a clearer consensus of what people thought they were answering. To echo Howard's point, looking at this chart or figure, the way that the questions are currently stated, it does seem like that line should not be there. But I think we have to go beyond that because the questions, the way that they were asked in themselves are flawed. You're not getting at the answers that you originally intended to get at.
That's why I think there's some interpretation that's called for. And you may interpret it differently, one from the other. Yes, sir.
Marvin Fair. This is a general question that pertains to this as well as the other charts. Did you determine the standard deviation?
I'm not a stat person. I let them do that. So it's basically the important thing here is the sampling error, which is, like you said, it's 5%.
Plus or minus 5, I think, is where we are.
So I guess if you could interpret it differently then, as I've said, generally positive, that's in the generally positive is because if people did say, we want to remove, but the point here was that they were willing to keep it on longer than the 3 years until everything was stable. Now, if you change that, you want to interpret it differently, then it would be 34% would be positive, and 64%. Yeah, 64% negative, the difference would probably be, don't know, not sure. If we look at the overall satisfaction with the services that the city has done in since 2004, you'll see very little difference across the years. We ask, just to show you 2010, the questions that we ask, about curbside trash collection, weekly curbside recycling, fire protection, paramedic services, cleanliness of our parks, paramedic protection, those all, or police protection. Those came out to what we would call better than 8, very good. And these are the same ones we asked year, all 3 years. Then we asked, one, the next highest one was condition of the parks, stormwater runoff, twice monthly bulk trash, the amount of water pressure, neighborhood street repair, street reconstruction, amount of large community parks, and requiring property owners to meet city code standards. Those were all in the 7s, which you would consider good on a scale of 1 to 10. What we look at as fairly good is communication with residents, traffic congestion on the major streets, arts and cultural events, and the water quality came in the 6s. Attracting quality jobs to our community, 5.9, and public transportation, 4.6, which is lowest every year. I wanted to compare them at least to the last survey so you can see the differences, so I divided them into two charts, with those rated over the 7.5 on the first chart and under 7.5 on the next one. The only place where we see a significant difference on the rating from 2007 was on the twice monthly bulk trash. And that's the service that we changed twice in recent months. And it was rated one of the highest in 2004, and now it's 7.6, which is still fairly high, but not as high as it was when it was weekly. The others that were rated under 7.5, when you compare them to 2007, the communication with residents is lower. Traffic congestion is definitely rated higher. And attracting quality jobs is rated lower. Because we asked the water quality and water pressure questions, but because they differ, you know, we have LIPSCO in the north and the city of Goodyear in the central and south area, I thought I should show the differences. And the water quality, we rated excellent to good by area, is only 47% overall, with the highest being in the LIPSCO area. The lowest being in the city of Goodyear area. And by water pressure, no difference by which water company. Then we ask about the importance of the city providing services that they don't provide now. Senior services was the highest rated, 89%, as it was in 2007. The new question we asked this year we didn't ask before was about after-school programs, which rated very high at 83. We also ask a new question about neighborhood circulator buses, which rated fairly high at 61. But most of the services that they would like to see are transit related.
These were listed. They're not open-ended, right?
Anything that was listed is rotated when they ask the question. So senior services is never always first. It's rotated every time they ask the question by the next respondent. Multi-gen center rated significantly lower than it had in 2007, performing arts as well, and the aquatic center definitely lower than it had in the 2007 survey.
Are these the only nine that you asked, or were there others that you asked?
The only ones that we asked.
Okay, so you asked about nine items, and this is the ratings that those nine got. Okay.
We ask another question about how the following amenities, how these following amenities will improve Goodyear's quality of life. And in this case, it was building a freestanding library, which was again number one, Astoria Falls Mall, and building a 4,000-acre job corridor came up as the highest three. And those are just over 7.5. Under 7.5 was bringing ASU, bringing private colleges, building the city center, the multi-gen center, which hadn't been asked the previous survey, and the Performing Arts Center. Again, the building the city center and the Performing Arts Center and bringing the private colleges came in later than lower than it had in the previous survey. This is the first year we asked them about bringing ASU.
And these are the only eight that you asked about. Can I ask a question on these last two slides? How do you decide which nine or which eight to include on the slides?
Basically, the type of things that we hear people ask for, that things that we don't have.
But who's making that decision? Who decided which eight were going to go on this question and which nine were going on the other question?
It goes before the director team, the management team.
Of what, though?
The city.
So it's the city council that decides?
No, it's the city management people.
So the city manager is the one who chose the eight items and the nine items to ask?
Paula?
Wait, you know, I'm asking her, okay?
You're not listening. That's the question. That's
Paula,
the problem.
Well, I'm asking her who made the decision and what the eight or nine things were.
I respond to you.
Okay.
We actually sent it out to the city council also and asked them. I mean, and then we left it up to the professional firm to make the decision. I didn't make any decisions about what should be on there or not.
So that's my question. Who did decide?
We send this out to all the directors. We started with this in 2004, so we sent it to all the directors to see if they want anything new or any changes.
And I'm sorry, when you say directors, do you mean like the police chief and the fire chief?
Directors of the city.
Okay, everybody who's either internal or operating directors. And they're asked, give me what you want us to ask about?
Yes.
Okay, and then some list comes back, and then how does that get to eight or nine items?
Basically, if they really wanted to ask and other people agree, then it's on the list. Bringing ASU, of course, council was interested in that. The previous one about after-school classes, Councilmember Osborne asked to have on there. So
if someone's really interested in something, they'll say, I really, really want you to ask this question, and then that's how it gets on the list. Okay.
I had a question, please. Scott Mikes, for the bringing ASU question, was it how new amenities will improve Goodyear quality of life if we bring in ASU? Is that kind of how it was worded? So if we bring in ASU, would you think that's it would increase the quality of life?
We said to bring in the ASU new college concept.
But just to bring in it, not like as far as, so just to see it here, not as far as like the funding piece of it or anything like that.
We also ask how much, because the Arts Council wanted this question. They wanted a lot more, but we had to limit the number of questions. So we asked this one question for the Arts Council. How much does art in public places help define a community? And basically, about 78% were positive, said it a lot, or some. And I would say, you know, if you want to be, say, really positive, it's the white lines, the white bars, which would show that there's really no difference by age, but in the South, they definitely are more interested in art and public, in public places.
May I ask you a question? So these become what you might call advisory. If I'm a director and I'm hearing some buzz and I say, I want to test this buzz, because these are only new things that could conceivably be added, but are not budgeted for. Is this to test the marketplace to see if there's a broader support for even discussing that further?
Every year there's a certain amount of new questions that are added that weren't added in the previous years because it wasn't an issue in previous years. And for instance, the Art Commission wanted to came forward this year, and well, we actually, I don't even know if we had an Arts Commission in 2004, but they wanted some questions on it. So we cannot ask too many, so we talked to them and asked one primary question. Okay, the multi-generational center, we asked them because recreation needed to know this. If we build one, what do we need to put in it? And so the number one thing they wanted is an indoor gym, followed by fitness equipment, classrooms, indoor swimming pool, auditorium, performing stage, kitchen. We asked whether each time, 2004 and 2007, have you contacted the city in the past year? It's always about a third who have. And we said, when you contacted the city among those who had, we said, were you treated courteously? And this is a yes and no question. And basically, and then we said, were you treated in a timely manner? So this is the first year that we've seen a decrease. You know, if you look at 2004 to 7, there was a significant increase in perceived level of service. This is the first time we've seen a decrease in the perceived level of service, even though I guess you might say 85% is pretty high. It's not high enough by our standards. So when we saw this, we've already started we've had less training in the past 3 years than ever before with the budget cuts we've had. And so we've already instituted a new consumer services manual. It's been sent to all the link to it on our e-site, internet site, intranet site has been sent to all employees, and a message from the city manager.
Is Mike Yex, the contact with the city, that's in any office, that's in
any office, any contact.
Anything associated with the city of Goodyear. Okay, thank you.
How people, now this hasn't come up for a long time, but we had it on the 2004 survey, so we thought we would, there was interest in council keeping it. At the end, when we did the 2004 survey, the Public Safety Committee had just finished their work, and they had recommended that they wanted the fire sprinkler ordinance reinstated for new homes that are constructed. It had gone down to defeat in a referendum earlier. And at that time, 68% were in agreement, where this time 72% were in agreement. The interesting thing we saw this time is 32% said strongly agree. And there's been no publicity or no discussion about this in the past 3 years. And before that, only 23% strongly agreed in 2004. So it's interesting that it's gone up, even though no one's really been talking about it. And when I looked at the demos, it's strongest among the under 49 age group and significantly more popular in Australia. Now we look at readership of the West Value so we know where to place our advertising to reach the most people, and of the local newspapers, and of the West Valley View, basically 88% of the population reads it occasionally, 66% at least weekly. It comes out twice a week. That is a little less than the number who read it 3 years ago. Some of that readership is going to the Southwest Valley Republic, where in 2007, it was fairly new. 53% never read that paper, that in the tabloid, and now only 43%. So the readership is going up for those who read it at least weekly. And that comes out 3 times a week. We wanted to know the frequency of the readership of our newsletter. I mean, we spend money on our newsletter, and we think it's important to communicate with everyone. Back in 2004, it was inserted into the West Valley View. When we got this data in 2004 and saw that 53% of our population seldom or never even knew it existed, seldom read it and some never knew it existed, that's when we decided to mail it in-house so we'd get better readership. So once we started mailing it in-house in 2007, we've gone now up to about 71% of the population that reads it most or every issue. 54% of the people this year said that they read every issue. And when we wanted to see the age group and analyze the readership, but basically the differences in the age group, the higher the age, the higher the readership. And I think that's really common. You can expect a lot more online from the younger people. So next is we wanted to know how many people had internet access at home. That number really hasn't changed much. It's about 85%. Let's So therefore, how many people have used our Goodyear website? This year, it was 74% of those that have internet at home. And that's a good increase from 2007, when just over half of our population had ever visited our website. And as we looked at the by age group, you'll see that every age group has increased significantly in the usage of their website in the past 3 years, particularly those in the 35 to 49 age range. They basically, for all these years, rated the same. It's very easy to use. This year, they rated it 7.8 overall when we ask them, just give it a rating on a score scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the highest. And because we redid it in 2008, and hopefully that's somewhat helping gain usage of the website. And those are the youngest, under 35, had a mean rating for it of 8.5. So it appears that we need to use two different mediums for sure to reach the entire population, both the web and the printed media. And we asked the frequency of using the bulk trash. Because it was done twice, was done weekly in 2004 and 2007, I'm showing this to you separately, because we had to ask the question differently. They only had a choice of weekly or two times a month, and 25% of the population used it at least two times a month then. 75% of the population uses bulk trash monthly or less. Now we ask in 2010, how is that now that we offer it only two times a month? We still have about 25% of our population that's using it twice a month, and the rest, 77% of them, still are only using it monthly or less. Back in 2007, when we asked about the possibility of changing City Hall hours, at that time, I think Avondale was the first city who had even hinted about changing their hours and closing on Fridays. When we asked that question then, 67% of the people said it was okay with them to close on Fridays, and 75% said it was fine to extend weekday hours longer on Monday through Thursday. Well, now, this year, those numbers are significantly higher, and that could be because you're reading about a lot more cities doing that. It's a lot more common today than it was in 2007 when we first asked it. Then we ask about the all-mail ballot. It's somewhat more expensive for us to do, but we ask them overall if they prefer the all-mail to the to going to the polls, and you have 80% of your population that really prefers to have the all-mail ballot as opposed to going to the polls. So in summary, about 40% of people have lived here 5 years or less. About half have children at home across all age groups. So we have well-educated households, with 85% having a college head that's had some college, and more than half of them with a college head, household head with a college degree. The income levels are basically the same as they were 3 years ago, about three quarters of the population making over 50, and half making over 75,000. 76% of our employed households commute out of the city, with 80% driving 20 or more miles round trip a day, and 40% driving more than 40 miles round trip a day. 90% still think it's a great place to live. 85% think the quality of life in their neighborhoods is good. The central area showing the only area that's less happy with their quality of life than others, and that was 76%.
Question on slide 49. The annual salary, it says half of households. That's combined incomes?
Yes. Of household heads.
Of household heads. Doesn't say that.
Doesn't include, if you have a 17-year-old working, it's probably not in there. It's of the household
heads. Yeah, but if it's two people, I see 75.
Sorry, what?
If I see two people and it's 75, I'm getting a different figure per person.
It's not per person, it's per household. Okay. 98% of the people said they still feel safe in the daytime, 90% at night. One-third have contacted the city, and courteousness and timeliness were significantly lower than 2007. They need improving. The biggest problem they say the city is facing is the budget problem, 14% on an open-ended basis. And there were a lot of little teeny things, and open-ended, they could have said taxes, 3% of the people, 14% added taxes is their answer. The other things that they said were economy-related, foreclosures and jobs. More than half think the city doing a good job in balancing the budget. And basically, if you took all the people who are willing to keep the tax on for 3 years, that's 75%. The city could be more livable with more parks, recreation, and jobs, and shopping. The residents are still satisfied with city services at 92% rate, most satisfied with fire, trash, and police, and the twice-monthly bulk trash still rated high, but it was not as high as it was in previous years. What is not doing as well is the public transit, bringing jobs to the city, the water quality, and communicating with residents. Services that they are important that we're not providing are senior services, after-school programs, and transit services. And bringing the library, a mall, and developing a job corridor would do the most to improve their quality of life. On the university issues, bringing ASU got a 7.4 rating and bringing private university to 7.1. 38% are interested in a college degree, primarily a bachelor's in either healthcare, computers, technology, and business. Over 70% agree with the idea of a fire sprinkler ordinance for new home construction. 75% use the bulk trash monthly or less, and art, about 3/4 say that it helps define a community. 3/4 of those with home internet have used our city's website, which is up significantly from only half the population in 2007, with obviously the youngest using the web the most, the oldest are improving. Almost 3/4 of the people read, most issues have been focused, with over half of them reading every issue. On elections, the vast majority, 80%, prefer the all-mail ballot. And on city hall hours, 80% agree with closing on Fridays and 85% on extending weekday hours, if that's a suggestion.
Not necessarily on subject. You may or may not necessarily on subject, but you may or may not know the answers. So I'll throw it out there. Do we know, we've got 80% of the people prefer mail-in ballots. Do we know in our last election what the percentage of registered voters who actually used that service was? Does any, that may be a question we could throw out in the air.
I believe it was in the neighborhood of 27%, but we'll have to get the specifics for you. Is Lynn here? Rourke, do you remember?
The number sounds right. I thought the previous election was about 3%, wasn't it?
Something like that, yeah. We'll get that information for you, though.
Okay, and then the other question I get regarding that balloting is the cost of that. Where is that? Whose budget is that? Is that in the city clerk's budget?
Yes, it is.
And is it identified as mail-in ballots, or is it just?
It is now, I believe, yes.
Okay, thank you.
The 400 folks that were contacted, were they just detached single-family residential folks, or did it include apartment dwellers?
Anyone who resided in the city of Goodyear. Could be apartments, could be single-family, could be mobile homes.
So they drew out of the phone book? I mean, it was...
No, they're randomly generated. There's so many people who aren't listening to the phone book anymore. It's randomly generated telephone numbers.
Because some of the questions wouldn't apply to apartment dwellers, like bulk trash pickup. You know, so that's why I was wondering if it was just they got a database of just folks who lived in houses.
Limited to single family.
Paula, I have the information here. May 19th, all mail ballot, we had 27.56% turnout. March 10th, 09, we had 28.21% turnout. March 7th of 07, which was a regular election, we had 3.22% turnout. And March 8th of 05, we had 14.91% turnout in a regular election.
Is any effort being made to contact the people who have got cell phones?
I asked them that because the question was raised, and he said at this point they, their technology cost, I think they said it costs lots more if we want to try to get cell phones.
Most people don't have a landline.
The difficulty with surveying with cell phones is the lack of a directory.
But and most people do not have a landline, you know that.
I don't know that.
I'm not sure it's the majority at this point.
It is now. It's been that way for over a year.
That is something that behavior research is aware of.
You have to get that information. Or else you're driving blind. If it's true, it's a disaster.
I think the assumption that's made is if you reach 400 residents randomly selected, unless there's some differentiating factor that makes a cell phone user substantially different in their viewpoint, that if you get 400 people, you have a standard deviation of 5%, you got a 95% accuracy in the data that you achieve. Now, we could ask behavior research if they believe through either their research or others that the absence of cell phone connections diminishes the accuracy of data. We'll get that back to you, but we'll ask behavior research that question and see.
Marvin Fair, this is a very minor comment, Paula. On chart number 31, you don't have to go back and look at it, but I believe Lipsco is now called Liberty.
Yes, sir.
Harry Gelzer. Paula, have we ever compared our data or our satisfaction survey with any other city surveys that have been done so that we can compare what we're delivering to, say, Avondale or Phoenix or Surprise or Glendale? Have you ever been able to get any other statistics like this?
Well, the ICMA is trying to come up with a standard survey that you can ask, that cities can ask, so they can do compare between cities, not just say within Arizona, but all over the country. The problem that we had, and we looked at it, it would have cost us more to use theirs and do it with them than it would have to do our own. And once we've started tracking information, we wanted to keep tracking our questions to see how we're going year to year, or every 3 years, 3 year period. So if we decide, if enough cities, and a lot of cities have the same problem, they've been tracking their own questions in the way they've asked them for years. So for all of us to switch over to one common questionnaire so we can compare data will take a lot for all the cities to do. So there may be one or two questions within that are asked exactly the same way. You know, Scottsdale's quality of life question is always like 98%. In Glendale's, it was lower. It was only in the 80s, as I recall, when I did their questionnaire. So there are some that we can look at and see if we ask the same question. But if you just change it a little bit, you really can't compare it.
How we've been collecting data in the 90s, correct? Or was 2001 the first
2001 is the first one.
First survey that we ever did. Okay, thank you.
How is the number 400 determined, and is that enough for accuracy?
It's definitely enough. I mean, like, we had Dr. O'Neill from O'Neill Associates come and talk to the council about that very issue. I mean, if you think of, okay, the ratings that, you know, Nielsen does over the households nationwide, 1,200, that's the sample size. So it's not, you know, the bigger you get, the better you get. If we went from 400 to 600, I think we went from a 5% sampling error to a 4% sampling error. But it cost us another, you know, $6,000 or $7,000 to do that. So normally in your data, and like the city of San Diego, a lot of other cities do only 400 sample size. What you really, when you want to increase your sample size, is when you really, really, really want to find fine differences between your subsamples. Like right now, we may have 100 people in a subsample. Well, that's not a lot to look at. That's why you have to see a 10% difference to know it's a significant difference. So the city of Phoenix uses an 8% about 800 sample size, because I think they have whatever the number of districts they have 8 districts, I think. So they have 100 per district, because sometimes they want to look at their district. But that's the only reason that they have a sample size of 800.
Questions?
Okay.
Thank you.
Mike Yeck, I got a few real quick. I apologize if this question's already been asked, but relative to the mail-in ballot, do we have any estimate on what the savings would be as a result of going that direction to a pure all-mail-in ballot?
I can tell you a pure all-mail ballot, the charge would be $65,000 right now from the county for an all-mail ballot. Pardon me?
I recall it's higher than the cost of polls.
It is, I think, by $20,000 or so.
So it's more expensive to mail in versus poll. Okay.
I've got these figures then. Cost of all mail ballot for 2009 was $45,000 each of them. And the $65,000 is what the county has told us they will be this next year. And the cost of the traditional election 2007 was $15,000.
Second question. Paul, on chart 53, you talked about a couple of different things associated with hours for the city, specifically closing the city hall every other Friday and extending work hours. I'm kind of curious to know, has anyone tried to determine what the savings would be associated with that kind of a move?
We did.
Yeah, if I understand correctly, this has been discussed before.
It'd be about $30,000 in facilities.
So there wouldn't be any savings for lost time, sick time, or anything like that for the employees? Okay.
It's basically only for the lights and the city
and
hall.
And the air conditioner.
So if anything, there's a possible savings there. Is there any expense associated with that?
The only expense, I believe, is the, you know, inconvenience to the citizens, probably.
Okay, so, but dollars and cents-wise, I understand there's an intangible there.
Not that I know of, no.
Okay, thank you. That's all I have. Thanks.
I have one thing to say, Joan Shield, is you sampled 400 people, and it says that almost half of all the households make over $75,000 annually. I find that high.
25% refused to answer that question, as it says at the top of that chart. Now, when talking to the research firms, they said, in a sense, that what they found is usual, what their belief is, that usually it's pretty well spread across those who refuse. Because, you know, I said, well, is it more people who don't make a lot that don't want to say it, or is it people who don't make a lot that don't want you to know they make a lot? They said they think it's spread across. But by that becomes then 25%. That's based upon 300 people.
Right. And that based upon the fact they're telling you the truth. Because, you know.
That's why we ask a range. That's why we ask a range.
Because I looked at the demographics of the city of Goodyear off of Wikipedia, and they are a lot different than what you've come up with.
Because they're taking this off the United States Department of Labor. Do we check that?
We have, you mean from our sample that we do?
Do we compare it?
Our sample is somewhat undersampled in the north. We have 33% of our sample. We have 40% of our population, for instance, in the north. And we have 13% of our population in the South. 13% of our population would be 50 people we'd be interviewing. So they somewhat oversampled and got to 72 in the South and sampled 33% instead of 40 in the North.
Well, our figures differ, because I check your figures, I know them. The Wikipedia, which is always a questionable source, but it's sometimes.
We base it on our planning department.
But they base theirs on the United States Department of Labor, which is when people file their income tax. And you can, that's information that's available.
We base it on the households that we know that exist.
Why ask the question? It's already been done.
Well, it wasn't asked. It was to make sure that we were getting people that were within the right areas. It's not like, you know, 90% of our people came from north of
I-10. Parts of the city. You wanted to know different parts
of the city. Make sure that we had a representative sample across the city.
Well, the importance of this is we're talking about the tax increase we've had and the possibility, as it's been kind of tossed around, of increasing property tax and maybe other sales tax increases and so forth. So I think that is really important. is what the income of people make.
Paula?
We will post for you that data. Now, I'd rather go to labor standards having my own problems with Wikipedia. I know it's a nice source, but anybody can put data in that wants to. But if we look at that, we'll share with you what that data is, and you can look at the comparative relationship. I think we have to assume that when you call somebody in on an independent survey, you have to assume they're telling the truth, because we don't have a, there's no right. metric for adjusting that.
But
is that okay, or do you want more data?
We have other demographics, like Sites USA.
Well, why don't we share some of those data?
Well, the state of Arizona, the Department of Revenue would get the information as well.
Well, we buy demographic information, okay. which we can see how it relates.
And it's 400 people out of 62,000 or 63,000.
400 is a representative sample. You can base it. Can you speak to that, please?
Well, 400 would be a representative sample. I mean, if you want to just think largely about the census we're getting ready to take, there's no way to sample everyone in the United States and get a count for each household. So that sample that, you know, everyone sends out to, there's going to be error rate, there's going to be people that don't respond. But overall, I think whenever you're looking at surveys and you're looking at them, it's important to note that these are point in time statistics as well. They don't tell you anything about, if you're looking at Department of Labor, it may not be exactly consistent with when this was taken. So you can't look at them and compare them like it should match up exactly. Their point in time.
And Goodyear is a little different because we have a lot of retirees.
That very well may be true as well.
In that direction.
And that can be reflected in the data out of the north. Which is why I talked to the planning department to find out how many households physically we have in the north, in the central, and in the south.
Mm-hmm. When you asked the question of whether or not a person was a resident, did you ask them if they were a part-time resident or a full-time resident? Because we have a lot of snowbirds, and that may reflect why some people say they do certain things and they don't do other things because they're not plural.
We've never asked it that way.
We ask them, do they vote here?
Well, we ask if they were a registered voter, and 92%
here?
Here in Arizona. And so 82% of them were.
Mm-hmm. Paula, how has the city council used the information from these studies? Have they made any changes or made things better or worse? Or what do they do with the information after they've had the presentation? And
This presentation was just made two nights ago, so.
Well, they had them in prior years, though.
Right.
We added a library because of this.
We added some senior services, definitely because of this. We wanted the library's been number one, so that's why we wanted to get the library open.
The Arts Commission.
Arts has always turned up as important.
Mike Keek, have you stopped doing anything as a result of the survey?
Well, when we wanted to know whether we could go to twice a week bulk trash, the fact that over all these years, 77% of the people have only used it monthly. So we figured by going to 2 weeks, we weren't going to hurt too many people, going from weekly to month to twice a week. So that's one big one where we've used it. In the past, we've asked questions on whether they'd be willing to separate their green waste and things like that. So we have information over the years on people's interest in doing those kind of things for various different services. Anything else? Okay, thank you.
Next, we are going to have Harvey Krause and Dave Ramirez discuss development services. Are we okay to go ahead with that without a break? Who's going to go first, Harvey? You?
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Okay, good.
good evening. My name is Harvey Krause. I'm the director of community development for the city. A little bit about me. I've been with the city of Goodyear since June of 1990, just short of 20 years. So I've been here a long time and seen a lot of changes. Started, the population was approximately 6,200 residents, about half of which were in Perryville Prison. Can everybody hear me? This is not working, I guess. I had hair back then. I have over 30 years of public sector experience in Texas, New Mexico, and Wyoming in various positions. I have a master's in geography at ASU and a master's in public administration at UNM. And I did my undergraduate work back in North Carolina a long time ago. And been a certified planner since 1983 and a member of ICMA since 1991. I'll give you an overview of the presentation. First, I'll talk a little bit about the department's mission, a little bit about the organizational structure, and I'll spend a lot of time on community population, housing, and demographic information, which I think is important for you to get some background on the city and where we've been historically and where we think we're going. Major services and programs within the department, some fiscal impact, cost reductions that have been implemented by the department, as well as some efficiencies that we've implemented over the last year, or the last few years. The mission. If I can summarize the mission for the department, it's to identify and implement the community's vision for smart growth and quality development. And the community's vision is articulated in the city's general plan, which is adopted by the Goodyear voters, Goodyear residents, in November of 2003. And I'll get a little bit, I'll go into more about the general plan. But basically, the general plan is the blueprint for how the city is to grow and develop over the next 10 years. The two primary functions within community development are planning and zoning and development services, of which I'll give you a little bit more background. This is an organizational chart for the department. There are 15 members in the department currently. There used to be 25. The red boxes reflect those that have been positions that have been eliminated. 8 of those 10 were laid off last year, 2 of which found positions in other city departments. We have in planning and zoning, we have what is known as current planning, which is processing land development cases such as rezonings, use permits, annexations, subdivision plats. Long-range planning primarily deals with managing the general plan, population projections, socioeconomic data collection, and population projections. And then on the right-hand side, or my right-hand side, is development services, which is serves as a one-stop shop, is basically where an individual who wants to build something in the city of Goodyear submits plans to our front counter, and those individuals process those plans and permits with assistance from other departments, engineering, building safety, fire, and first I'll talk a little bit about the city's size. I'm not sure you have received this presentation, but the city is now 190 square miles. We have what is called a MPA, or municipal planning area, of just over 246 square miles. We, in 1946, when we incorporated, we were pretty small. It's just this little area right here, where my mouse is. We've grown significantly in the 80s, north of the freeway, as well as south of the freeway. 1980 in the 80s, we grew quite a bit. And then recently, in 2007, we added, since the general plan was adopted in 2003, we added 72 square miles, of which 67 square miles was the annexation of, we call the Sonoran Valley, which is that area that is south of Patterson Road alignment, which is in the brown, significantly increased the city's jurisdiction. To give you some perspective of how large the city is, 100 square miles, 190 square miles, city of Phoenix is roughly over 600 square miles. So we're less than, you know, one third of the city of Phoenix. Buckeye is also square miles, but doesn't have the population, of course, of the city of Phoenix. The difference between a municipal planning area and the city limits, we have jurisdiction, all our laws and ordinances apply within the city's jurisdiction, city limits. However, in the municipal planning area, our laws do not apply. However, this is an area that would be future growth and development. If urban development was to occur in the planning area and annexation was contemplated, they could only annex to the city of Goodyear. That would be the, and we use that area for planning for water and sewer, future water and sewer, and other population projections. In terms of community population demographics, we estimate our population, and we estimated in July 1 of 2009 as 62,554, and we believe that our population is roughly 63,000 right now. That assumes a vacancy rate of 7.8%, which is what was used in the 2005 special census. However, you know, looking at, based on the housing market today, things have changed, and I think we probably would estimate that closer to, based on some information we've seen, is closer to over 11%. our housing unit count is approximately 24,000 within the city. That would include all housing units, apartments, single-family dwelling units. Our growth rate in 2009, this is based on housing units, was 2.5%. We estimate that our growth rate will be roughly the same in 2010. Looking at some growth rate comparisons, obviously Buckeye has the highest within the Phoenix metro area, 4.9%. I believe Buckeye might be that rate is probably, I've seen studies, it's probably in the top 10 within the country. Ours is closer to in the top 25 within the country. The 2.4% is still healthy growth, 2.5%. Many Midwest and communities in the Midwest would love to have 2.5% growth, but it sort of pales comparison to what we experienced back in the mid to late 90s when we had 16% growth rate in the city. But it's still healthy growth. We believe it's normal growth. And, this is comparing, I believe the city manager showed you this particular graphic during his presentation. But you'll see the population being the blue line continuing to increase to the 63,000 population projection. And this is total, the red line is the total permits issue. This is every permit. This is not only new single family homes, but this is if somebody wants to add a patio under their on their house, or wants to change their hot water heater. This would be all the permits, as well as engineering permits, fire permits. So the message here is as the city, even though the city's the population of the city continues to increase, services increase, the total number of permits have dropped. Single-family permitting trends. These numbers on the blue line represent total single-family permits only. The green line represents a 2% growth rate, which we believe we're calling a normal growth rate. And this pretty much reflects valley-wide the type of growth trends we've seen on single-family permitting. If you look at the last four decades in the Phoenix metro area, the growth rate has averaged 3 to 5% overall, but there's been wide fluctuations in growth, and Goodyear is basically reflective of that type of fluctuations in growth. And as you see, everything above the green line here in the early 2000 was above the green line, and now we are below the green line. We project that normalcy, you know, will come to the housing market in 2012, and we have several indications that that's occurring. We base that on the forecast by ASU, U of A, and R.L. Brown do forecasts of the Valley housing annually. And historically, we've done about, we represent 4.5% of the share of new single-family homes that are built in the Phoenix metro area. But this past year, we've actually exceeded about 7% of the market share. So there may be a shift coming to the West Valley, but assuming a 4.5% market share based upon the estimates from R.L. Brown and are correct, you know, we'll be back to what we believe is a normal growth rate in 2012 in terms of housing permitting. The build-out, dwelling unit build-out based on densities in our general plan, land use densities, we believe over total number of dwelling units at build-out, there's a lot of things that can change on this, but over 253,000 homes. And if we look at what our current number of dwelling units at 24,000, that's roughly less than 10%. So roughly less than 10% of our land area is basically developed, so we have a lot of room to grow. Over 81,000 units have received final zoning. 11,600 lots have been final platted. Some of these lots have water and sewer and are ready to go for a permit. Others have just been final final platted and could be converted to houses very quickly. Population build out based upon the total dwelling unit count is 625,575. That's in the municipal planning area. So looking at historically, now how quickly are we going to build out and how's that going to happen? We look at the 1950 to 2000, these are actual numbers from our census in 1254 in 1950 to the 18,911 in 2000. We use MAG projections from 2010 out to 2030, and then from 2030 to 2050, we assume a 3% growth rate, and after 2050, we assume a 2% growth rate. We reach build out at 2060. So where is the build out going to occur? We divided the city into four quadrants for purposes of geographic distribution of build-out. North of I-10, I-10 to the Gila River to Patterson Road, and then south of Patterson Road alignment, which is primarily the Sonoran Valley area. So I'll give you that geographically here. How do we get to build-out? So the north of I-10 right now, we estimate is 56% built out with over 9,600 units out of the 17,000 that are projected in that area. In the area I-10 to the Gila, we're 40% built out with 11,000 units. And then south of the Gila, which composes mostly Estrella Mountain Ranch, is only 3% built out with 3,200 units of the over 100,000 units that are projected in that area. And of course, the Sonoran Valley, our newest addition to our community, really doesn't have any, there hasn't been any new construction in the Sonoran Valley. When we annexed the area, there were approximately 27 or 30 existing single family residents. So we have about 89,000 new dwelling units. And what does this mean? I guess this chart tells a story. I believe it's pretty critical here, is that right now between in 2010, the distribution of the city is 82% of the population is north of the Gila River, roughly. But by build out, 82% of the population is going to be south of the Gila River. So there's going to be a real shift in the geographic distribution of our population over time at build out, and it's going to occur fairly rapidly, I believe, as growth picks up again.
What was that year? Did you give a year? A year.
A year for build out?
Yeah.
Yes. I'm just projecting 2060.
2060.
A lot of variables in that.
Yeah.
We're presuming 2 to 3% growth. But historically, the Phoenix Valley has, as I indicated, has been 3 to 5, but there's been wide fluctuations, and I expect that. Unfortunately, we'll have that again in the future. That's the area of community population, socioeconomic data. Now I want to get into services and programs, talk a little bit about what the general plan, what we do in community development, general plan administration, implementation, development application processing and review, development services, the one-stop shop for permit activity, the community development block grant program, housing rehab, socioeconomic data, and some other services and programs we do. So first, the general plan. As I indicated earlier, it serves as a guide to effectively manage growth and development. The Goodyear residents ratified the general plan on November 4, 2003 by 80% vote. We're very proud of. We were awarded best comprehensive plan for the state, Arizona Planning Association, award the following year. We process minor and major amendments to the general plan and prepare city-initiated amendments. We monitor, of course, the scope, schedule, and progress of the implementation program of the general plan. And the state statutes mandate that we update the general plan every 10 years. So we are due for another election in the fall of 2013. I think we're one of the few states in the union that is required to submit their general plans to the voters for approval. Since the adoption of the general plan in November of 2003, we've processed 31 amendments. 20 have been major amendments. 11 have been minor amendments. We've collected over $345,000 in application processing fees. We also prepare a state-mandated annual report on the progress, even though it was required. I think we were the first city in the state to do that, and we received recognition from the Arizona Planning Association for that. We prepared a smart growth scorecard, which was a prerequisite for obtaining state grants, and we were designated a smart growth community by the Department of Commerce. This past year, we just completed a major update to our circulation plan, which now conforms to MAG regional transportation plans. The next area, area of services, I want to talk about development services. Permits. We ensure orderly development of the city through managing the development process and review process by project management of development applications. And project applications involves the technical review, monitoring schedules, progress, the public hearing process, resolution of issues and conflicts, coordination of the city team for rezonings, subdivision plats, use permits, annexations, site plans, building design review. We have an internal committee called a development policy committee that meets weekly, where we review these land development applications and formulate staff recommendations on those applications. Our department is also heavily involved in negotiating development agreements, easements, licenses, and other documents to facilitate development. We perform on-site inspections for landscaping, parking, building design, the walkways, signage for all new development. Primarily, what we serve is a one-stop shop for all permitting activity. receive and some review some minor applications, process and collect fees for all development-related permits and applications. We also scan and maintain all development files and documents. We calculate credits and offsets for private contributions as dictated by development agreements. What that means is we have 51 development agreements that are active in the city. Oftentimes these development agreements requires the developer to make upfront payments of development fees. When they make upfront payment of development fees or prepaid development fees, we have to record those. We issue them credit vouchers or certificates. They turn those in at the permit counter when they get a building permit. And when they get a building permit is when they pay their development fees. We have to keep track of that. Offsets are, developers are often required to build infrastructure as part of their new development, such as putting in a traffic signal. So a traffic signal costs $350,000. So $350,000 is applied to any impact fees that are associated with traffic impact transportation fees. So we have to calculate the value of that infrastructure and give them credit or offset towards any fees they have to pay. So we keep track of that. I'm going to give you a feel for the activity level right now and historically since 2006 when we were growing very rapidly. We had a lot more. This is just planning and zoning cases. When I say planning and zoning cases, I'm talking about land development applications, rezonings, use permits, site plans, annexations, residential design review. This is the total for that fiscal year, and this is an average per planner. After 2006, we began staffing up, and then obviously the caseload dropped, and now it's beginning to increase since we have reduced staff. However, with the trend we're seeing now is many of these foreclosed properties or distressed properties is often in, I guess, in the nomenclature now is distressed properties. Are coming back in the market. They've been picked up by other builders and developers, and now they're revisiting their, what we call their entitlements, is their zoning. They're revisiting their house products. They're revisiting their plats. They're changing their things to fit the new development model they have. And so they're meeting with us. And we've got several of these that are we've met with recently, King Ranch, Sedea, Las Palmas. There, several of them are submitting new plats, submitting revised zoning applications. So even though we don't have cases to represent this, we do see we're on the cusp of more development to occur within the next couple of years. The market turns around, we believe is in 2012, quite an uptick. A more recent example, 2 weeks ago, the grand opening at Canta Mia, which is formerly called Province, which was an active adult community that Ingle Home started a few years ago, and they went into, they became bankrupt or foreclosed on, and a new builder picked up that property, invested a lot in that property, spruced it up, and then had a grand opening and already began selling. Very happy with the results. So that's the kind of thing we're seeing. Many of these properties will be coming back on the market. And I think we're positioned really well when the economy picks up. In terms of total permits issued, saw that graph earlier from 2006 to projected this fiscal year, 3,200. This is the total number of permits processed per technician. Same type of a trend. We were doing quite a bit in 2006 per technician, and then we staffed up. Number went down. Now we have, since we reduced staff, that number per technician has gone up. The real telling times is the permit fees. This includes all permit revenue. This includes building permits, engineering permit fees. This includes fire permit fees, planning, case fees. Excuse me. It does not include development impact fees. That's totally different. So these are all fees. So we were doing 14, 13, and 12 million back in our the growth days. Obviously now it's considerably less. We also do, after we have contact with a customer, we send out via the internet a customer service satisfaction survey.
Sorry, question? Right here, right here. On the previous slide, your fiscal year 08 fees were $12 million, and that was about 6,000 permits, right? 5,788 permits?
That's correct. Well,
and in 09, you report 3,600 permits, but you only collected $4,700. So your permits went down by about half, and your revenues went down by 75%. Why is that different?
Well, a couple of things. Let me explain. In the permits issued, we did not include, permits, we did not include planning cases, but in the revenues, we did include cases. So you're looking at the 08.
Yeah, about 6,000 in 08 and about 3,609. So it's, 40% of the number of permits. Or I'm sorry, 60% of the number of permits. Well, but your revenues dropped by 75%. Are they just different, simpler, much simpler permits than?
Those permits, like I said, one of the permits could be Macy's Distribution Center, which is, the permit fee was over $1 million. We have a small, hot water heater replacement, which would be, maybe $50. So there's a wide variance in those types of permits.
So the number of permits that you're processing each year isn't necessarily representative of your workload. Is that what you're saying? Some permits take a lot more time and are a lot more complicated than other permits.
Well, a number of permits just reflects the workload. I thought you were reflecting with dollar value, but the number of permits does reflect workload. Yes.
It does. So a $50 permit takes the same amount of work as a $1 million permit?
No, not necessarily. It just reflects the activity level.
Yeah.
But it does take time. Oftentimes a small permit can take just as long as a large permit. It doesn't really.
Well, are permit fees more representative of activity or number of permits more representative of activity?
Well, the number of permits probably.
The number of permits.
Have you increased or decreased those permit fees individually?
The permit fees have increased over time.
In what increments? Can you give us a percentage?
Percentage. Are there various permit fees in there? I think engineering, building, planning, and as I indicate, fire, most of those have remained constant, except building permit fees are tied to a regional index and a multiplier, and they go up incrementally based upon, so they go up more regularly than the other. We're now doing a user fee study that Larry introduced, and we've reevaluated all our fees, so we'll be taking that to the, we are looking at redoing our fees citywide.
Question.
And that'll change.
Might it be helpful in the future when you do that study to get this slide a little more detailed? So these questions wouldn't, because there's a lot of things in here that are fuzzy.
I'm a little bit confused on why you are increasing those permit fees if you want to attract more business here to Goodyear.
Well, the user fee study is to capture our costs in processing fee, not necessarily to increase fees. Some fees have gone, in fact, in the user fee study, some fees have gone down, some fees have gone up.
Question, Joan Shields. I'm just kind of interested as to, I'm going back to where it says development services and permits and outputs, that in 06, each planner was averaging out 47 cases. And now in 010, they're doing
37. And if you were reducing staff and trying to get numbers up, why did you not pick where a person would average out handling 40 cases instead of 37? So that way it would still be room for growth. You know, they would still be able to handle more because in 06 they were averaging 47 cases.
Well, this is just actual data. We're just reflecting what the activity level was. There were we're projecting 147 cases this year. There might be more, there may be less. We're just projecting out the average number per planner, just to give you an idea of how activity level has changed from 06 to 2010, that's all. It doesn't totally, as I indicated earlier, it doesn't totally reflect the activity level because there's a lot of other things that we do other than just processing cases. I talked about the general plan, socioeconomic data. We talked about meeting with developers and getting property ready for the submittal of a case. There's a lot of time and energy that goes into before a developer actually submits development application. We have a lot of meetings with that individual or individuals and work out the details before they ever come to the city. So this isn't total reflection of workload, but it's one barometer of it.
Is any of the work in the department, is it all in-house or is any of it outsourced?
We now do everything in-house. It used to be we used consultants. We know we eliminated that as part of the reductions. We eliminated all consultants. We do everything in-house. I was going to go over those in just a minute. Are there any questions? More questions on that? We do a customer service satisfaction survey, and we've received 100% feedback since August of 2009. As I indicate, we have 51 active development agreements to track.
Sorry, a question on that last slide. Who are your customers?
Developers, builders, citizens, anybody that comes in the front counter and gets a permit from us primarily. Those are the people that we have contact with. Submits a land development application.
And how did you figure out that you had 100% positive feedback from developers, builders, and those type of people?
Well,
did you do a survey or something?
Yeah, we did a survey. When they have contact with us, we obtain their internet information, and then as soon as they leave after they get a permit, then we follow up on the internet and send them via our internet a survey with about 6 questions and satisfaction, were you treated fairly, you know, and give them a range of, I don't know, 1 to 4, and all of it has been positive. We haven't received any negative feedback.
Are they anonymous when they return them, or do you know who they're coming from?
They're anonymous.
So what would you attribute a 100% positive feedback from customers? I've never heard of any organization that had 100%. I'm not disputing that you have 100%. I'm just asking you, what do you attribute that to?
Good customer service.
It must be outstanding, unbelievably fantastic customer service that you're giving to all the builders and developers who are coming to Goodyear.
Well, they don't, you know, often, you know, the way I view it is they may not like our answers, but at least we give them answers and we are courteous
right away,
about it.
Yeah.
And we do it in a responsive manner and a timely manner. So I think if people are treated fairly and courteously, I think we get.
Do you think 100% positive feedback from customers is an appropriate level of service for any organization?
It's tough to achieve.
Well, I don't think
it's a good goal.
Yeah, I don't think Mercedes-Benz has 100% positive customer feedback, or probably Tiffany's.
Okay.
Just a question.
Excuse me, Mike Keak, one follow-up associated. You mentioned timeliness.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
You mentioned timeliness. Is timeliness one of your 6 questions?
Yes, responsiveness, how quickly we are.
Thank you.
Marvin Fair.
On the development agreements, does that include the full current and future and present impact of that development in terms of cost to the community? Or in other words, is there any set aside for future taxpayer coverage?
Well, the short answer is no. I mean, we have very few development agreements are the same. These are over time. These development agreements stretch back 15 years, maybe 20 years. And so they're different in a lot of cases, and they do different things, address different things. Often development agreements are used in Arizona primarily, and well used in the city of Goodyear, where developers will either outline Van's infrastructure, what they're gonna do and what the city's gonna do, how much they're gonna contribute, if the city's got any responsibilities and the developer has responsibilities in terms of prepayment, building things, and timelines, that's what it's about. Does it reflect the full cost of development? That's the impact fees are supposed to theoretically ensure that new development pays for its share of growth and the existing residents that are here don't have to pay for new growth. That's what impact fees are about. It's a tough measure to achieve all the time. So I guess short answer is no. To answer your question, I don't know if I answered your question or not.
Thank you.
I just wanted to point out when you mentioned the 100% positive feedback, that doesn't tell us anything about your sample size. So it's this
53.
Is 53 out of the thousands that are hundreds that have received permits.
Oh, we've gotten 53 responses back. Okay. We've gotten 53 responses.
And how many total permits have you processed? Or how many total internet addresses, email addresses have you gathered and sent the survey out to?
2009.
What?
Since whenever this was, since August of 2009.
We've sent out 53 and we've gotten 53 back, we've gotten 53 responses back.
So you sent out 53 and we got 53 back.
I believe that's correct.
Any other questions, folks?
Harvey. Gary Gelser, could you elaborate on how much each in development fees each new single-family house pays to the city and what categories it covers in general?
Well, it covers utilities, water development, water resource fees, water resource meaning the water that goes in the pipe, water development is the infrastructure, sewer, reclaimed water, that's the utility side. And then it talks about general government areas. We do have a category for general government, for city hall, libraries, police, fire.
What's the dollar amount per house that's added on to each
I think it's
new
16.
Permit?
It depends because it's
generally
different. It's different north of the freeway, south of the freeway.
Average.
16,000 south of the freeway.
Thank you.
9,000 north of the freeway.
No libraries.
It's different if it's
we do have libraries.
County. It's county.
Sorry, I can't hear. It's
county.
We collect a library impact fee.
Okay.
For new library facilities, and we contribute towards that library. We also administer home and CDBG grants, which is Community Development Grant Program, which is to low to moderate income housing rehabilitation program. Maintain records for past projects in accordance with federal requirements. Provide fair housing information and training. Create and update federally required 5-year consolidated plan, which represents the community's project priorities for CDBG and home funding.
Question, Mike Yek, on the grants that you just spoke of, as a part of that, I don't know if there's an application. application process or how those grants get funded, but
sure.
Is that a source of revenue for the city?
Yes.
So as a part of that revenue, does that also pay for the management and administration of the grant, or is it just pay for the benefit of the grant?
It pays a certain amount of administration of the grant.
Part of the administration costs associated with these grants is paid for as a part of the grant?
Yes. A portion of it.
But not all of it?
Not all of it.
Where does the rest of the revenue come from to pay for that?
Well, it's usually in-kind contribution. For instance, we have an individual in our department that manages the community development block grant program, and there's a certain percentage of the grant can be applied towards administering the grant. We either buy that monies to in-kind contribution or to hire someone outside to do it. Since 1992, we've rehabilitated 88 homes within the city for low to moderate income residents. It's over $2 million investment in the community. We received $127,000 in FY09. We invested $1.2 million, this is of CDBG funds, in the infrastructure improvements to Western Avenue, the park, the benches, the change in the street frontage in Western Avenue. We also did some waterline replacement in historic Goodyear. and we received $400,000 of funds for that. We just submitted two new applications to the county for park improvements and housing rehab this fiscal year. And in fact, tonight they're the committee that is evaluating those applications tonight. And grants fund or supplement other capital projects that would otherwise not be done. So this water line replacement, this Western Avenue redevelopment and parks improvements wouldn't be done or would be done with general fund monies if we didn't get grant funds for that. Yes.
Marvin Fair, so the city only has one redevelopment area, the Western Avenue?
Well, that's the only money that only grant monies we received to put into redevelopment. There are other areas of the city that could be.
Okay. Now, are all the redevelopment areas funded only by grant monies?
Well, I don't know. When you say redevelopment areas, we don't have that many redevelopment areas, and we haven't invested that much of city funds in redevelopment over the years. First of all, we don't have
Marvin. Yes, as far as monies that are spent are only from grant funds.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Mike, yeah, you know, question. Are there any pending grants that are pending award or that you've got submitted outstanding?
Yes, there are two applications for this year. Parks improvements of $550,000 and then another housing rehab at $70,000.
Any other grants that you guys are contemplating filing?
There are other grants that the city is contemplating. I'm not privy to those. But these
relative
are,
to your purview?
These are the two. These
That's
are the
it?
Two.
Okay, thank you.
We also compile, analyze, and distribute data used for state shared revenues. We give the data to MAG. DES prepares the, calculates the population for state shared revenues. We use that. The data is used for grant opportunities, preparing city budgets, marketing, economic development, and water resource and public safety planning. We prepare a monthly dwelling unit report to MAG, ASU, and the Census Bureau. Participate in the census program. I think it's interesting to note that in the 2010, we found that like Canada Village was part of Pebble Creek census tract. And so since it was part of Pebble Creek, it didn't qualify for grant funding. So we've been able to work with the census to take Canada Village out of Pebble Creek's census tract, so Canada Village can be eligible for grant funding in the future. So we're working on that. That's one example of how we participate in the census program. As I've shown you, we work on creating and update build-out projections for population, housing, prepare reports on land use, demographic, and development trends. And of course, prepare five-year projections. Some other services that we do, we administer the kiosk sign program. This is a program that our department initiated and was was the first in the valley to do, and several other cities have emulated this program. It was to get rid of, I don't know if you know, many years ago we used to have these weekend identification signs. They used to pop up in the right-of-way. There were hundreds of them all over the place. And to get rid of those, we decided, well, we're gonna have our own signage program in our city right-of-way, and we'll require builders to participate in those signs. And they'll pay a fee to a sign company, and the city gets revenue for that program. And it cleaned up our community. And other communities such as Avondale, Surprise, I think Gilbert, have copied our program, which I'm very proud of. And then we also were involved in administering the monument sign program, those Welcome to Goodyear, those pylon signs you see in the median. Hopefully you find those attractive. Also working on a EIS, an environmental impact statement, for the Sonoran Valley Parkway. A road is needed from Patterson Road alignment down to State Route 238. Working with the BLM, that's needed. Also, we're a cooperating agency on an EIS for the Sonoran Solar Energy Project, which is about 4,000 acres outside our municipal planning area, except for the water portion. But it will impact traffic and water within the city, so we're working on that closely with BLM. That's a project initiated by BLM. We worked on the city center site planning and building design, MAG transportation studies, and of course the zoning ordinance update. Fiscal impact cost reductions in our FY 10 budget. Our budget now is roughly $1.5 million. Our budget in, last year was $2 million, over a $500,000 reduction, which reflects about a 26% reduction. 40% of our staff has been reduced. We've eliminated the use of outside consultants, which saved $20,000. We've brought in all employee, or for the most part, all employee training and development is conducted in-house, which saved $10,000. We no longer accept credit cards for payment for fees. We used to take credit cards, MasterCard, Visa, American Express. We no longer do that because we had to pay a fee to the company, and that was costing us anywhere from $50,000 to $80,000 a year. So we eliminated accepting credit cards, which is a little bit of inconvenience for our customers, but it saves us money. We now require all fees to be paid up front, before we would reconcile fees at the end, because some of the fees were computed after the plans were submitted, and we'd reconcile it well before the permit was issued. Now we require all fees to be paid up front. So those are some of the cost reductions.
Excuse me.
Yes.
40% staff reduction, I assume that that's a percentage of number of staff. What was the dollar amount that you saved from reducing 40%?
Well, it was 25 employees, reduced it to 15 of the $533,500, roughly 95% of our budget is personnel, 5% is operating. So the lion's share of its personnel. I don't know what, so the lion's share of its personnel. Another chart, I believe, that the city manager showed. This is all development services revenues compared to the number of employees in development services. Development services being community development, engineering, building safety, fire inspection, plan review, comparing with how revenues had trended since 06 to FY10 and where we're at.
Does your number of positions also include building safety and fire inspection personnel?
Yes. 51. Yes. So anybody who touches a permit or is involved in the permit process or plan review process.
The numbers that the budget regarding the number of personnel assigned to planning and zoning are not necessarily reflective of what's on this slide. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Harvey, is the number of people on the slide here, is that the up and down part, is that reflective of
fantastic efficiencies you've created, or it has to do with the workload decline?
That's a loaded question.
I mean, can we expect the curve to go back up as the permitting activity goes up?
In the short term, probably not.
So maybe
we've done a lot of.
So maybe your 100% satisfaction survey will drop down to 80 or something.
Well, I mean, what we've done is we've implemented some technological improvements that I think that have saved staff. I'll give you some examples. In building safety, they've done an IVR interactive voice response system. So now all inspections can be called in through, called up and automatically checked, and they can find out what the status of their permit is, and when they get an inspection, they can call automatically schedule an inspection. Used to be done manually. Now it's done through that. Engineering has done, they do through Project DOS, they're able to have electronic plan submittal. So plans don't have to be coded to the front counter, they can be electronically submitted. So we've done some technological improvements that I think will save us time and staff over the time. And as I think we have some other ideas on that too. This is one just to show all of development services staff and number of permits per staff, and just to give you some barometer of activity. Same kind of a trend, fairly high in 07 and went and goes back down. Some efficiencies, yes?
Just a quick question. For every house in our city, do you maintain a file of all the permits that have been associated with that house?
Short answer would be no. After time, we don't have it for all permits. We have a lot of them, and they're through HTE, through our computer system. Over time, we can track most of the permits, but not all of them. As I indicated, the user fee study is being implemented, hopefully this year, which will be an efficiency. We've started a couple years ago administrative plat approval rather than taking those through a formal planning commission, city council approval for minor land subdivisions. They pay a fee, they get staff approval, they don't have to go through. It makes it quicker for the developer, easier for the developer. Another cost-saving measure that one of our employees suggested, which we send out notices to citizens within 500 feet for a rezoning. We used to do a letter. We're going to reduce that to a postcard. We're going to save them postage and time. We do a web-based notification subscription for documents, so as new policies or new things come out or a change in policy, we send it out through the web, and they can also comment through the web back to us. I started a quarterly development advisory forum, so every quarter I meet with developers, builders, and we go over issues that they have and review new policies and procedures and answer their questions. We've done cross-training of development services technicians too, which has saved time and energy. So that concludes my comments, and be happy to answer.
I have a question. Joan Shield, you have all these projections in here for 2010. Is it possible to get actual numbers for the last 6 months?
We'll give you whatever actual numbers we have, okay. Yes.
Harvey, going back to the org chart, you showed a planning manager long range and a planning manager short term, or current planning, I'm sorry. That's the rationale that you use.
Yes.
Or the name, I'm sorry. How much long-range planning is actually going on right now? It seems that everybody, particularly in the development community and all of us, are planning for what's going to happen 6 months from now, a year from now. How much long-range planning is actually going on?
Well, a considerable amount of long-range planning is going on. We have there are two planning managers. It was recommended in our matrix study that was done several years ago to structure planning and zoning with under current planning, which is ongoing planning, and then long-range planning. And this structure was set up when we had more employees. So we recognize there's an issue, there may be an issue there. So we're reevaluating that, and we're looking at reorganizing planning and zoning to reflect more of a different model now that we have less employees.
Okay, and then the next question I have is regarding the permits. The number of permits issued now are far less than they were even back in 2001. But obviously the size of the organization is significantly larger than it was in 2001. At least according to the numbers that are published in the budget.
Are you looking at community development, or are you looking at development services overall?
Well, I think that's probably where the confusion of some of this data comes in, is we're given the generalities of the budget information lumped together in community development, for example. And that, from what I understand, encompasses you and the engineering department. Is that correct?
Well,
I'm sorry. Engineering is split out.
Yes. The problem with comparing apples to apples here is that we've had community development used to be engineering, used to be building safety, and planning and zoning. It used to be a larger department. And over time, we've had a number of reorganizations, so things have been split out and changed. And consolidate. I think David in his presentation might go over that a little bit more. So things have changed over time. So it may be kind of confusing in the budget. And it's difficult to compare apples to apples because of the reorganizations that have occurred over time.
Okay. Then the last question I have regarding this end of the presentation was the revenues. In your slides, you talked about $14 million and $5 million, et cetera. That money goes to the general fund. Is that correct?
Yes.
So it could theoretically be used for anything.
Yes.
Right? And there was a point in time when you were, or essentially were revenue neutral, where you were actually bringing in, or even revenue positive, where you
were
bringing in far more than you were expending. Okay. I just want to make sure there wasn't any confusion with the permit dollars that they were going into the general fund, et cetera.
We are not we have not been run like an enterprise fund. You know, we.
Harvey, in fact, even right now, you produce way more revenue than your expenses, because if you'll notice on the chart, it says that the revenues are estimated this year at $4.6 million. And the expenses of the department are only $1.5 million.
I have one final question, and it's more of a gee whiz thing, but are we involved, the Sonoran Valley Parkway EIS, it's an environmental study for a piece of property that is under development agreement for presumably now a future developer. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
So.
Why are we doing that
when development's supposed to pay for itself?
Bill, that's a good question. Well, we have the developer that we had a partnership with and had a development agreement with had a commitment to do that EIS and to build a road roughly 15 to 18 miles, depending on what alignment's chosen. He began the EIS, the process, through BLM, so there was over $100,000 invested in it, and we annexed the area for a number of reasons I can go over. But we have a commitment to serve that area now that we've annexed the area, and we need a road primarily for public safety purposes. So we will get another developer partner someday to build that road and to assist us in that effort. But until then, since we had the EIS started, we felt that it was prudent to move forward, because the EIS doesn't go away, it doesn't expire. So once the EIS is completed, hopefully we'll have a developer that we can get to reimburse us for our costs of preparing that EIS, as well as assist us in building a road. So we look at it as an investment. I know at time, it's a little bit difficult to assume now, but it's a capital project. It was roughly $350,000 is what our investment in that EIS is over time. But we think over time it makes some sense.
Thank you.
Going back to the 40% staff reduction, if I'm following your calculation, about 95% of the budget is personnel. I'm seeing, according to my calculation, based on what you have given me, the reduction in salary is only 26% when it comes to dollar amounts. So why is there, how would you explain the big difference between the number of staff reduction versus the actual dollar amount that was reduced?
I'm not sure I can. There were several, we had, as I indicated, there's consultants, and there were consultants that were reduced, training, development. We reduced operating costs, too. I guess I'd have to do the math and figure out exactly how much of that, of those 10 employees cost the city to
Harvey,
reduce it.
It was also heavily in the consultants. We had Brown working for us to the tune of $1 million during the heyday. I mean, so there were cuts like that in your budget that added up tremendously.
Anything else? David's anxious to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Harvey.
Dick?
Yes?
I'd like to make a recommendation that we don't have any more PowerPoint presentations tonight, and that we have an opportunity as a group to discuss what we've learned so far. And I see that in the next meeting we only have municipal courts and there. But I would really like to have an opportunity to talk with our committee with as a whole of what we've learned. We're getting down, I mean, we don't have a lot of time left.
Right. That's
doubt. I don't know about anybody else for tonight, but
other thoughts on that?
Well, as a facilitator, what are your thoughts on it? I mean, you're the one who's kind of managing the meeting, and if I look at the resolution, there's five items that are asked of us to do in the resolution. One is to get informed. The second one is to provide input on services and program priorities. The third is identify cost savings. The fourth is identify revenue. And the fifth is to advise City Council.
Right.
Well, as I look at the agenda, we're going to spend 27 hours getting informed, and we've only left 6 hours to do the other four things. So in your mind as facilitator, what was your plan to get the four other things done in 6 hours?
Well, I don't think we get it done in 6 hours. I think that when it comes to I'll go back to the beginning when we talked about what a report might look like that goes to the council. And again, the reason I say, what do you think, is because this is your committee. I'm a facilitator. I'm not the director. So you've made several changes in the structure along the way, and that's fine. So the first question I will always ask is, what is your preference? If you ask mine, I'll be happy to tell you what it is. The way I would, we have a lot of information still to cover. And you essentially will be loaded with ideas that you've got, perceptions that you've got, things that you want to share. As I mentioned at the beginning, my recommendation to you would be, after the final presentations and any follow-up questions that you've got being satisfactorily answered, that you each write your report. I'll recommend next week a structure for that, but you don't have to take it. It's going to be very simple, very straightforward, based on those 5 points. That report would be perhaps turned in March 31st. Since you've been taking notes, as we discussed at the beginning, I'm assuming you've got a lot of ideas that you wanted to put together. That could be turned in March 31st. My role, my responsibility, is to take each and every one of those reports and read it and bring back to you for your approval and your review a summation that could be then given to the council on your behalf or by you in any way that you want to do it, but it would represent everybody's perspective, but summarized and prioritized based on the weight that you would give things collectively. I would then attach to that report each and every one of the reports that you wrote in its entirety. I would suggest you take the names out, but that all the data is there. So when you look at the summary report, you can connect your own input to it to see if you, in fact, have been represented in a reasonable fashion. That's what I would suggest that we...
Wait, so you're saying we all submit a 27 of us, whatever there is.
That's
submit
correct.
A report to you
yes.
on the 31st. You're
yes.
going to go home and read all 27 reports and summarize them somehow.
That's correct.
Into here's what I think the major findings were.
That's correct.
There's going to be no discussion amongst all of us about
you can
what's
have
important
all the
or not
well,
important.
Well, I think from the 31st you can do that. You've got a whole 3 hours on the 31st to have that discussion. But I think by that time, ideally, you would have your individual ideas pretty well framed. You can also add dates if you choose to. You can add the 17th or the 16th if you choose to. But you've really got three full evenings if you choose to add the 16th that are completely open for follow-up review discussion.
March 16th?
I beg your pardon, sir?
March 16th?
Yes, because we don't have one scheduled and didn't in the original schedule because of the use of the room. On Wednesdays, so we could simply move it to Tuesdays, and you have three full days. But I'm also presuming you're doing a heck of a lot between meetings, because that's where the real work gets done. So I'm wide open for your preferences for tonight, because we can move something
next week. When you say a heck of a lot between meetings, what do you mean by that? That we're studying all this information, or are we supposed to be meeting with each other off-site or something, or trying to come to some kind of conclusions, or what do you mean by that?
What I'm presuming is that there is far too much data here for you to simply digest and fully understand on terms that are satisfactory to you in the 3 hours that we have. So I presume that you, because I get emails from some of you asking follow-up questions and making comments, that you do some reading and studying of this in between. I think that kind of goes with the role. Should you be getting together? That's up to you. As we talked about in the beginning, how you manage yourself outside of this meeting individually is your business. How you set a set of standards at the beginning that you wanted to follow. And so those are all that I'm concerned about, and the direction of the council is really... So if you have meetings outside, that's your business. But I presume that before coming here, there's been some thoughtful consideration of the information that's laid before you, that's posted every week on the website, or that came up at the previous meeting.
So, Dick, this final report that you've discussed, need that be a paper report, or can it be an electronic report, or how do you see that?
Well, I think given the nature of documents that go to councils, I think it's a written report. I would suggest that you all sign it. I would suggest...
No, I'm sorry. This is our individual input to you.
Oh, any way you want to. Absolutely any way you want to. But then the double check on that is it'll all be attached to the report that goes to the council. They can read each one individually if they choose to, or they can read what might be reasonably called an executive summary. If there are other, jump in. I mean, that's simply...
I missed the first part because I had to take a break. But is it, so I can understand it. So there'll be ideas that we want to submit as a recommendation.
Yes, sir.
And we're going to make those up, give them to you, and you're going to give them back to us, and then we're going to look at them as a group.
Yeah, you look at the report as a group. Yes, sure.
See, I had in mind that we would do something like that. Everybody would come up with ideas, and they would be thrown on the board someplace. You'd put them down, give it to staff, let staff cost it out to see what savings or new revenues would be generated by those, come back, and we'd vote it up or down as a recommendation to council.
But take it with the same general process up to the point of staff.
Except...
And one of the things I have not suggested that, because that's something if you choose to do, I think it would enrich the report in some ways, but for some, they would believe that that was not part of what they would have wanted to see. So I'm not recommending that. But if the group sees that as an integral part of getting a productive solution at the end, fine. Then in that last week, it would be given to the staff. It would add a little bit of time, but it would still give you the same result. but with a little more information on the report. So you might have committee suggestion, staff comment, if you chose to have that. Yes, sir.
Gary Gelzer, it seems like some of the committee members would like to benefit the committee with the nuggets that they've been able to mine over the last 7 weeks.
Great.
And I would be happy to take 10 minutes before David Ramirez does his presentation, and let's go around the room and see if there are any nuggets that are going to be tossed out, and let staff cost it out like Larry suggested.
Well, we, Mike, yeah, I mean, we went through a list of potential revenue.
Right. Yes.
I think that particular objective, we certainly spent quite a bit of time brainstorming as a group.
You got 15 or 20.
Now we know the cost of those revenue generations, I don't know, but
we have
one of the objectives. I think we did a pretty good job so far as collaborating together as a team, and we put some things out there. Is that the model we want to try to follow for the other objectives as a part of what we're trying to accomplish here? I mean, that's a suggestion.
Now, some they can be certainly costed out. I don't think we've put a lot of time into those. Those were a brainstorming session.
Right.
Yes.
That can mine those ideas and can then consolidate them down into some major topics and be able to feed off of the energy of one another as opposed to each going back to our own cubicle and writing a report. And I guess I would prefer to have the interactive discussion and the mining of the ideas here.
I support that.
I think that's the right way to do it, too.
Okay. Other feeling about that? Is everybody?
To piggyback on what Evelyn was saying, is I was thinking the very similar idea, and I'm looking at the agenda, the revised agenda here, or not the agenda, sorry, the outline for the next few months, or weeks rather. And March 10th, there's one presentation, Parks and Rec, and March 24th, there's Ballpark and Municipal Court, both of which leaves plenty of time at the end for us to sit and collaborate and share ideas. And I think if we at least have that opportunity to share our ideas, even if we do an individual report, we're at least collaborating and we can kind of build on each other's expertise and experience to give our individual reports a stronger
I think it's
emphasis.
Very helpful tonight to hear what you had
mm-hmm.
in mind,
right.
Because that allows us the opportunity to go home and to kind of look through this and see if, I mean, maybe a homework assignment, send each of us back to come up with 3 to 5 ideas so that when we come in, we're prepared to share those. But
right. And I think that's a fine process, and you could do that in small groups. There's a variety of different tools. One of the things I want to make sure you each individually understand is that you were asked as individuals to participate and as a group come up with something that can be recommended. But as individuals, I don't want to shortchange anybody's individual opportunity to make comment. And so if I'm very happy to do something like that, and maybe you do it in tables of 5 or 6, and then we gather it on flip charts and call it down. But I still want to give you the freedom to write a minority opinion if someone.
I appreciate that. But until you, I mean, when we talked about revenue generation, we just brainstormed a whole bunch of ideas.
Right, right.
So we didn't talk about which ones we thought as a group would be more effective or more important or more bearing on the problem the city's facing right now. We just threw them all down, we collected them, and we walked away.
Right.
I guess that from my perspective, where I think that the collaboration needs to occur, I think we need to go look at that list of stuff and fundamentally decide, okay, of all the things that we identified there, which ones do we really want to focus on, either asking the city to go off and try to estimate cost savings from, or which of the ones do we believe, even if the city can't answer the question, which of the top five we really want them to go address as a group moving forward in terms of whatever the resolution of the budget issue is. I mean, I guess I don't I agree with the comment that we don't need a bunch of separate reports or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I think we should put something up on the table and we should talk about it as a group and make
yeah.
it join it, get a consensus and,
okay.
and narrow down the focus. Maybe not to everything. I mean, I could come up with a list of 100 things to do, but that doesn't necessarily help
right.
this committee or the city move forward with acting. I think it's our responsibility to tell the city what we as the committee
absolutely
are the most important as a group.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps we should meet the 16th.
Pardon me, sir?
The 16th, perhaps we should meet this for discussion.
Well, that's important. Do you want to meet on the 16th, folks?
Just for our discussion, no one else.
Well, I think it's, you mean no presentations?
No more presentations. No.
Well, you have to, you still got a couple more to finish this out.
We can decide whether they're 1.5 hour presentations or we just need 45 minutes,
sure.
Right? And I like this woman's suggestion over here where maybe as early as next week, everybody for this week be given a homework assignment that next week each of us should come prepared if we want to give our general impressions or specific recommendations on any of the five items that City Council has asked us to look at. And maybe it's something as simple as, you know, each person's got a few minutes to talk about what their things are, and then by a hands up or down vote, we say, you know, which of those things do we think we ought to put on the next step list of ideas that as a committee we think we could get consensus on. Keeping in mind that there's always the ability of anybody to write an individual report or a dissenting opinion report that might not agree with the consensus of the committee.
But do we have to wait till next week? I mean, can somebody just receive all the ideas during the course of between now and next week and just compile that?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I mean, that's a way to do it. Send them to me.
Right. So that of the five categories, you put up a list of what everybody's reported out to you.
Absolutely.
That is a starting point for discussion.
Do me a favor, though, and try to limit it to your top five, let's say, in each category. Or
well,
something
how,
to at least
how are
get
you
a
structuring
starting
this?
Point?
We're saying just particular cost reduction ideas or particular revenue that we think are most important.
Absolutely.
Not a general impression of what we've seen thus far.
That's
not,
correct.
No one's looking for that type of overview.
I don't think so.
To me, that would be the most. If I was on the City Council, the most valuable thing would be I got 27 citizens together, and overall, this is what they believe they learned and heard, and in two or three paragraphs, this is what we recommend you do.
Oh, I'm not suggesting that that's not the outcome. No, I didn't understand your question.
What are we talking about? What are we talking about relative to cost reduction? What are we specifically talking about with
right.
revenue reduction or generation? I think you kind of need to put pink some, I don't know.
I think you have to start as specific as you can. That's all I'm saying.
The conclusions we draw from that is what needs to be incorporated as a part of the final report.
Yes, sir.
Would it be advisable to do this after we look at the comparative budget data and listen to the city manager's office?
That comparative budget data is going to be very useful to you. You've had a lot of interest in it. You'll have it next week.
I think we need that before we can pursue what everybody's talking about.
We can continue to throw out more ideas. It's not like, I mean, we don't have to wait for the whole thing. I mean, I agree. I mean, we can start throwing out stuff right now to get some stuff or some ideas going, and then, you know, as we get more and more information, then we can, you know, cross it off the list or whatever. So, I mean, you know, I think the idea of the 3 to 5, you know, send them to you. Okay, this is some stuff that we have going so far from the committee, and that gives us a chance to, you know, it's nice to hear what other people may think, and then that gives me a chance to go back and kind of look into those ideas. I mean,
I agree, because I'm concerned if we're going to get to the point where we actually want the city to go off and do something for us, I think we need to start giving them a heads up what we're thinking as far as where we're going to want them to go do some additional investigation for us. I mean, there's a certain amount of time here. We can't show up on the 31st and have all these great ideas
and
have no specifics behind it.
Well, what?
Not helping anybody.
Yes.
I'm Joan Shields. I also think that as we move forward, we're going to have more questions. Like, I have a couple of questions
sure.
of the city manager. That I would like to have answered. And as we dig into this, we're going to find that we're going to have more questions of the other other departments. So
what I'm hearing from some is that a change that you what you'd like to do is begin to get specific and share your interests and your perspectives.
Parallel process between continuing presentations
right.
and now starting to build the final.
If you wanted to send those to me, addressing each of the five questions that Howard just mentioned that are in the original charter for this group, I'll compile those into.
It's really only three. because the first one is get information, which we're already doing, and the fifth one is report to city council, which is what
the ones that call, the one, the 5 points that you made and the ones that call for commentary.
Yeah,
right? And send those along. I'll compile them without editing in any fashion other than to make it simple. We'll put them in a fashion that we can. I'll probably have them on charts rather than project them because you lose them after you go from one place to another. I would suggest that you consider an open discussion. That's fine. Maybe you want to break into 5 or 4 groups so that you start to have a more specific discussion around with a few people. Do that randomly is the best way to do it. And see what you come up with as your list of key items in each area to share forward.
And I would agree with the gentleman who suggested we have those to be submitted by March 10th rather than by next week, because I think it might be important to see this budget information before we actually do it.
Is that except folks, I mean, a few join in the conversation, but all have interest in the outcome.
Well, I guess I'd like to see a skeleton of what the final report looks like, and based on the skeleton, if you really think there are things that are there, make the decision at that point to break up and go work on specific actions.
Wonderful. Okay.
But I want us to all agree, some degree of a consensus, on what we think are the key items that we want.
I agree, and I agree 100%. My vehicle was perhaps a little more weighty to get to the same point. Now, so I need to really understand, as it's described, which is generally clear, more specific data, you put together information, send it by the 10th, I'll compile it in a way that's easy to read. Yeah. So the question is what was just framed what you want to do? And which means you'll do this work by the 10th, you'll send it along, we will try to create a document that represents a consensus viewpoint, continuing to allow you to submit individual dissenting opinions or attachments to it as you will.
Yeah. Are you also going to call our other team members and find out why they have not been adopted?
Anyone who has missed 3 meetings will receive a phone call from me this week where I'll share the information that we've got over there for them, find out if they want to continue to participate, and what I can do to be helpful to them if they do. So everybody who was selected, I don't want to presume that anyone is not involved, so I will find out.
So
the calls were made this week.
Mike, yeah, based on confirmation that there are people who no longer want to continue, are we going to rethink, like,
I think we simply have a smaller group.
Right. So, okay.
There's no mechanism for replacements.
That's what I wanted to know.
Yes, sir.
So
Dick, I'm just checking a little bit for understanding
yes.
with regard to the things that you expect to receive information
yes.
from us about. One would be input on services and program priorities.
That's correct.
One would be on potential cost savings.
Yes.
And the third one would be on new revenue sources.
That's correct. And I think there was a subset to that we discussed, and that was any other suggestions that you might have that could improve the system. And that was implied within that.
I'm sorry, could you recap again?
The 16th in or out?
We haven't gotten to that yet. We're still on point A.
Okay.
What was that first one?
Okay, the question is agree to the
Oh, I didn't even know we were voting yet.
Well, I think just on just one point.
What's the point again?
Point is, do you want to follow this framework that we've just discussed for the last several minutes? And the reason we vote, because we have a smaller number participating than in the discussion that would represent a majority. That's good. If you say agree to the framework described, that would be fine. So if you would push your buttons.
And for those that wanted me to read that again, the first one was input on services and program priorities. The second one was cost savings. The third one was new revenue sources.
Thank you.
And the other one was just a general suggestion.
General implied. Anything else you'd like to share? Okay, folks, if you would, please. Push harder, right, push again. Well, it's pretty clear. So even if there's one missing, what the heck? Oh, the next question is just put 16th, yes or no. The 16th is the other, the extra meeting.
That is again a Tuesday, isn't it?
Yes, it is a Tuesday.
Are we voting on that one?
And that was going to be just...
The date's going to be important, yeah.
And also, the agenda for that meeting was going to be purely discussion amongst our group.
Clear. Well, it'll be the follow-up on all of this that we're collecting. Mario just went to check to make sure the room's available on the 16th.
Is that a Tuesday?
Yes, sir.
Is anybody willing to do it on a Thursday?
He's going to check on both dates. Yes, sir.
Dick, is there a way?
Thursday, by the way, if we're going to, I'd prefer to kind of stay on the schedule, given my travel schedule, but it's preferable to me to do a Thursday versus a Tuesday.
Yeah, travel.
That week.
Anytime we move the schedule around, okay?
Are we backed up against a zero date of some kind?
The end of the month has been our goal. We would have to see just how far we can push into April, but I think there's some room.
Wasn't it my understanding from the mayor that we had clear off until the end of May?
Well, I think that, no.
Not for it to be accurate.
No, not to do the job you're doing, but the preliminary budget has to be adopted. You have to have this in a time that can be in a process. It can't drop in like a parachute.
Dick, either date works.
Either date works. So let's start with point A, 16th or 18th. So how many?
Can we add a third one, which is the Wednesday further down the line? So that we stayed on Wednesdays, in other words, what would
you then skip, and just skip the 17th?
Yeah, and then just go another Wednesday.
April 14th.
Yes, we can do that. So I'm trying to think which question to start with.
What are we doing?
Okay. Let me frame this. Then the first question would be stay Wednesdays, add one.
Can we just do three options? So third week in March, are we going to add?
That's correct. If we would drop, this is the question, drop, just have no meeting on the 17th.
Okay, and no Wednesday.
But add a Wednesday to the end of the agenda. So that's this first question is no meeting. 17th, no meeting 16th, no meeting 18th, but just drop one meeting.
Add April 14th.
And add April 14th. Yes. And then if you go with this one, we don't have to go to question two and three, right?
What did you say, add April 14th?
Add April
yeah, just 14th. Say add, if you say just add April 14th, that'll do it, Parrish. Your plans.
I can't. We're closing a house up in Washington State. I have no choice.
Just add April 14th. Are you ready? Okay, folks, please, if you would. Yes or no, add April 14th. Which means you got a week off on the 17th.
What are we going to do?
They can play poker. Have we got 18?
Yes.
And this, right? What do you got? Okay. Well, there are some no's. But we have a clear majority of yeses. So we will not have a meeting on the 17th or that week. We'll add one in April. And we will go through the process that we discussed here, right? You'll send that information to me by the 10th. And if I have that all compiled, I'll probably just email it all out to you in a form in advance of the meeting.
Our brainstorm on the revenues and stuff like that, we put them on Post-it notes up there. Is there?
We have those.
You have that list you could send out or something.
I'll make sure we do that.
I would appreciate it just whenever you get
it. Did you just say you'd email us what you would like on the 10th?
On the 10th would be the answer to
the
initial
presentation.
Yes, sir. Which had the three specifics and then one general. Anything else you'd want to add? I'm just trying to make sure that this is broad enough to capture
like
all your ideas. Okay, we need to move on to one more presentation, which will take no more than 18 minutes. It needs 30, so I think we're, unless you want to talk about something else, we should adjourn tonight and tag that on.
Wait.
Because I can't ask him right now to cut it in half.
I agree.
Is there anything, folks, for the good of the order that you would like to throw on the table?